igual, te viste. Quité, we got to be good.
Okay, so for the welfare of public assistance this evening, case number 2015-007. The board is authorizing, or in this motion, $900 in rental assistance, that payment will then close case number 2015-007.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you, Caroline.
Good night.
Okay, let's see. I'm gonna march through department head business, even though we have no more department heads, just to see if there's anything. Okay, here we go. So, one, under builder inspector, we talked to Gary Fieldson about his issue on Pinecrest Lane, referring to the planning board. Two is the housing standards ordinance.
I reviewed them today, the Dover edition and the Rollinsford edition, which uses the same exact,
Sequestering?
Yeah, no, not sequestering anymore, because I'm not putting them away.
Sequencing?
Yes, sequencing, what am I saying?
I don't know, sequencing.
Yes, sequencing is what I was trying to say, Lord. Anyways, the numbering.
Yes.
For Dover and Rollinsford, you recall, it's exactly the same. It's verbatim. And even including, Rollinsford kept the city solicitor references, so it needs cleaning.
We don't have a city solicitor.
No, we do not. So I'm going to, it's not a, it's a PDF, I believe, if I recall correctly.
Didn't we ask Kristen to put it into a...
No, that was a different file, but I was actually going to call her and ask, or email and ask her if she'd be willing to do it.
Yeah, there's, she has some software, if she can't do it, I can do it, I mean, we can certainly do that.
But that's a...
Okay, so, well, keep in mind, when you're ready, when you think you have a final product for the board to review, we would need to have a public hearing and all that jazz, so...
I'm hoping to have something for you to review next week, and then we can start scheduling.
Okay, that's great, thank you, Mike. Okay. Health inspector, South Street dumpster, I know that we asked Caroline...
I went there today. It was 59 South Street, right?
I'm not sure, it's the original email, it's not on the agenda, 50-something sounds correct.
I think, or was the person who was complaining...
I think that was the address of the person who was...
So if that's the case, it looks like it's been cleaned up, because I looked at both sides of the street.
Did you see a dumpster?
Yes.
I went by quickly a few days ago, and I didn't even notice a dumpster, so I don't...
That's what I'm thinking, it's the other side of the street, so...
I see.
So I believe they cleaned it up, but it wouldn't be bad if... The health inspector or the deputy.
Yeah, so...
I think should take a walk, literally should take a walk down South Street, starting at the corner of South and Second and South, going to Fourth Street, looking at both sides of the road. There are properties on either side of the road, several on both sides of the street in that stretch.
Would you like to send Tom an email to that?
Yeah, he needs to look.
And the reason I'm saying Tom is because we're not hearing back right away from Sean, so as our deputy... And building inspector.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you. No fire highway. So I believe, Mike, that you, I'll let you take your note there, but I believe you have something to tell, that you can tell us about.
Yes, I do.
Prospect.
Well,
yeah, tell me.
Let me pull
up
my note. We'll talk about some the several properties that I like to just stack garbage up in the front lawn, so it's delightful. Let me put my note. So the road agent and I went to Prospect Street and Pine Street last Wednesday. So 442 Prospect Street, which is the...
That's Mr. Brunel, that's the brick columns, right?
Yeah. So the columns are 13 feet from the center line of the road to his columns. The utility poles that are also on the street are 18 feet from the center line. So
13 feet?
Yeah, they're
how wide is Prospect? It can't be very wide.
Well, it's it's probably about 26 feet, actually. 25 feet. From pavement to pavement, it certainly is.
So it's your according to the measurements, then his columns are in the town's right of way?
You know, the times, and I had a nice conversation with him, he explained the other times that.
Mr. Brunel, he was there?
Yes, he came up, yeah.
Okay.
He, we had a nice conversation about when a fire truck backed into his column, and.
His column, maybe? There were two instances anyway.
The fire truck certainly sticks out in my mind, but it was clear that it was an accident by the town. The town, but that being said, it's also within the town right of way, so.
So what is your recommendation to the board?
If.
How did you leave it with?
I said that I would discuss with the board the right of way. The distance between his pole and the street, that's it. And that's it, just come back and do a report of how far the dimensions were, that's it, so. I made no promises, one way or another, so. So let's just think about that for a moment. But Pine Street is the one where we definitely know through our work with Hoyle Tanner that it's a 20-foot right of way. And in some places, I think he said 30-foot right of way, depending on what part of the road you're on.
From the center.
From the center, right? So the photographs that Jeff sent last week, week before
mm-hmm.
last, of these stones and the thing, and the side of this person's
mm-hmm.
hill, what they consider theirs. The furthest stone that's up from the side of this little hill is 18 feet from the center line. So well, all of it's well within the town right of way. None of it is. Now, I will say, though, that if we used the 30 feet, I believe it's 30 feet, is the 30 and 40, I think, is actually on.
Last
year. Yeah, do you have last week's minutes there? Accessible? I don't know. Let me give me a second. If Hoyle Tanner is right, I mean obviously this is well within. It's well within the
Hoyle Tanner
was
50 to 40 feet
right away. So 20 to
Twenty-five. Kind of section, so.
Okay.
So it certainly is well within our
right. All right. So, are we comfortable with having Caroline draft something on our behalf, and either she was on it or I tweaked it inside it, to both of you saying that certainly with Pine Street, I mean the stones are in our
Pine Street.
It's winter,
clear.
I think, is what we
right.
It's winter in New Hampshire, so we can have her do that, and I can sign her or she can sign it. Whatever the board feels more comfortable. What about Mr. Brunel? It sounds like also it's if it was associated with the plowing, the snow policy says that.
All right. So Mr. Brunel did tell me that his utility pole used to be closer to the columns,
mm-hmm.
and he had it. He sold a right of way. To the public service back then. He believes for a dollar on the whole street. Everyone on the street sold this right of way to Eversource. To be able
so
to put the
our
poles
right
back.
Of way is also Eversource's right of way?
I'm
is
just
that
telling you what the man told me. So I don't know if that's. I don't.
Is it, is it relevant?
Well, I'm just saying the utility pole is much further back than it's called. That's all. But Eversource, or public service at the time, is the entire street. I checked several poles, I didn't just check his. They're all 18 feet in, so they don't just put a big pole willy-nilly.
And his comes out?
His column is out 13 feet. So it's.
So his telephone pole is 5 feet further in than
his
column.
His column there. And I looked at the, so I looked at the thing,
but
the
what
column.
What about the damage?
It's just one brick on top that's come undone. And
can you do any masonry?
No, but I'll tell you this. I also measured.
I won't.
I measured
fair enough.
Just to see, measured the plow wing on the particular plow that goes on that particular truck. there's no way. One is, it's a good, trying to think of, it's almost 15 inches, 20 inches, I'm trying to remember, I didn't write that down. Below where this brick came off the very top of the column, it's not. And so then I said, okay, well, let's just say for sake of argument, the next size truck did that street that one particular day. It's still, the column is much taller than the wingspan on this one, on the next size of the truck up. So this, it would be rather difficult for this plow to damage.
Do we know Mason's just might just be able to just.
Well, I don't.
I don't want to open up that can of worms.
No, no, we don't. You're right.
Because
then you're talking. Yes, yes, yep. I'm so sorry. Sorry.
That the town has a.
I got it.
I appreciate your thoughtfulness.
Yeah, and I, you know, I do as well. But honestly, it's one brick. It's not.
Understood. We will write him another letter.
And I looked around the back. It's not like it's all.
It's not all in pieces.
Just the one brick.
Okay, well, thank you for your research. Appreciate it. Do you have any questions?
No.
Thanks. And I'll have Caroline or I'll draft something, and we'll get that out to Mr. Brunel. And we'll refer to our snow policy and the fact that the columns are in our right of way. Okay. Smoke test notifications. Caroline has sent letters out. I mean, we're going to do sandwich boards and put something on the website as soon as we know. We're now trying to find somebody to conduct the smoke test. And if you're awake, you know what I just sort of jumped into.
Yeah.
It sounds good. So we've been trying to get a hold of Bill Belanger in Dover, who did offer to come and help us, but he's not been available. I found a name through. Pardon? He is retiring, I've heard. So if you jump, no, that was Doug Steele.
Okay.
Doug Steele is also retiring, but I've heard that Bill Belanger is also retiring. But in any event, so I had another contact through New Hampshire DES, and we're following that to see if we can find somebody to do the smoke test. Foundry Street, swale damage. That refers to the cutout of the additional parking spot that Mr. Osborne has made. And did you see Caroline? Caroline said she did contact him, and he says he did last fall when we made the decision. And he didn't have time to come talk to us, and he understands it's not his property.
Okay.
So I think his concern was that, well, as long as I have as much dibs on it as the garden club does. Well, at this point, we don't have to worry about that because, you know, Jeff is recommending no parking, right?
So if we did turn into a parking space, he's just saying if he had company over and they wanted to use it, he would be able to use it, saying he hasn't been to the public?
That's his understanding. I'm not saying that. That was his understanding.
I just want to make sure I was understanding what you were telling me. Okay.
I mean, we could still,
at
this point, though, you know, based on Jeff's recommendation, we're not going to use it for parking.
I did go over and take a look at that as well. That was on our trip over to
or
back from.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's.
Well, we might have recommended like 2-hour parking, you know, some kind of limit.
Whatever,
right?
I don't know why.
But based on Jeff's recommendation, there's just not going to be any parking because it's going to be a swale. It's not a driveway.
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
So are we good with.
Yeah,
the no parking, Jeff will put a no parking sign there.
Yeah, where is everybody from the garden club going to park?
You can go into the garden club, it's just not easy to do. It's a little rutted and stuff, but I think with the work that they do, you know, doing a driveway apron, it will make it a little easier. And I know we're going to have some volunteers from Liberty Mutual over to do some work in that front part, off the road.
So, like, if you were heading towards Main Street on Foundry, you could pull to the side, as long as you didn't have a passenger trying to get out of the bushes.
It's not.
I mean, you could.
It's not optimum because you're in the driving lane, actually.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
And so, it's better to have off-street parking.
Yeah, I disagree.
And so, there is off-street parking, maybe for one or two vehicles, so the garden club's gonna try to expand that to three or four. And, you know, at first we thought, well, if we clear it out, we could get to that spot from inside, right? But I guess there's a kind of a ditch or gully, so it looks like that's, that part doesn't work. So I think there's enough room for the garden club to figure out parking, off-road parking, without even having to deal with.
On a really busy Saturday, how many, or whatever, you're busy doing, you just don't know, how many cars do you think are down at the time?
Usually, isn't more than two or three at a time. You know, gardeners come at odd hours of the day.
Sure.
You know, people who walk the trails sometimes can start from the bottom, from the library part.
Oh, wow.
Go up and walk up, so, So, any questions on that?
No.
Okay. We talked about Kellen Road, driveway on Stockdale. Well, Caroline mentioned it to me today, so I can tell you what she talked to me about, but I would be better to have Jeff here. And someone who lives on Stockdale, I think, wants to widen their driveway. And so I guess it's going through Tom as a building permit sort of thing. Well, it is going through Tom as a building, you need a building permit. You may need other things to be asked to check.
But it might have to go, it might be site review issues. I mean, it depends on how, they might have to go to the planning board. In fact, I'll talk to Tom about it first, but I would be shocked if it did, to be honest.
Where those lots are certified.
Yeah, exactly. No, exactly.
Okay,
yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Well, that's good to know. I mean, not that it wouldn't have happened anyway, but we'll send Tom an email to make sure that he's aware of that.
I'll add my email.
I don't know what the number is. I just have Stockdale.
Driveway.
Widening. And I think, Caroline was concerned about the increase in impervious surface. And it's effect on stormwater management, which is
right, true,
but we don't have the stormwater controls passed yet from the planning board.
Right.
And I believe they're only for new development.
New construction.
Yeah,
right.
New. So it wouldn't, you know, it wouldn't work. Okay, we've talked about the rocks on Pine Street, Volvo backhoe that's just been tabled, and Jeff is not here to go into non-public, so I think we're good. No, it was, according to Caroline, he was going to talk to us about something. I don't know what. But he's busy street sweeping because of the possibility of rain.
Rain.
Okay, so let's go to town administration. Under appointments, Caroline did find an old contract for planning board. She's in the process of working that out with John Krebs. So when it's done, we'll get it. Mike, have you heard anything about whether Governor Sununu has signed the... Is he expected to?
All bills, then after they've been passed by both chamber, they go through the all bills process, and that can take, depending on the desire of the person that's in charge of the enrolled bills process, which would be the Secretary of State.
Oh.
See where this may become complicated. Then sends it to the governor to make sure all the statutory references are correct. So I don't know yet.
Well,
I've got to be there.
So I do know that once signed, we would need to have put it in the paper of record, the newspaper record. It's not sufficient to just have it locally the way we normally do public hearings. And so, can we tentatively set May 8th? to do this? We won't notice it just yet. We have time, but we have to get it on our calendars.
On our calendars?
Yeah. So, if you would check your calendars.
Okay. Every Monday.
Now. Is that a Monday?
It is a Monday.
Is
six
every
o'clock.
Monday is reserved for us.
At 6 o'clock?
Not a problem?
Okay. And I can get the notice ready.
Yeah.
I can put Caroline on notice to send it to the newspaper, and if the board is okay with this, as soon as we hear that it's been officially signed, we can proceed with with that?
And I'll let you know as soon as.
That would be perfect. Okay, lost my place on. Okay, water ban. Caroline, there was some confusion because when I checked the website, I saw that ordinance that I know we did not pass on the website. And so, I don't know what our, I was trying to find out what our water ban originally said.
It's just, as long as.
And I was going to refer to it, and that's when I saw that other ordinance, so. So I didn't put out any further announcements. Because I didn't find our original one, so if, as soon as I find it, unless somebody else has it, wants to grab something.
When we were trying to pull it up.
You read it last week?
Yeah, I think so.
Then I lost sight of it.
I can appreciate that, but for sure.
No, I done it right away.
Yeah.
Pardon?
You read it.
Where did you find it?
The
drive or in your email?
The one that.
The one that we did pass.
From the website.
Well,
both,
not the letter from DES. That was.
No, but she read.
No, it was right on our website. And I just, I think I searched water ban. Because it's obviously it's further down.
Yeah.
And
well, when I searched it, it came up with that ordinance, which isn't an ordinance because we never passed it. And that's when I went, oh, goodness. Emergency response to state drought conditions. The select board met on Tuesday. So when I check on this link, select board met on Tuesday. View the the ordinance can be found here. So when you click on here, that brings out that ordinance that we never passed. So. Okay, so the board voted to institute a ban on water usage. This ban covers residential uses and pertains to residents with private wells as well as residents. The ban covers the watering of residential lawns. Okay, so there it is. And I will just ask Tia to remove the ordinance found here. And I sort of came to here right away.
Oh.
And I missed that top part, so.
Yeah, I didn't go down.
All right. So I will just point to that and ask her to remove the ordinance, which we never passed. Thank you for helping me with that. Town Hall, Ronnie Wood on membrane roof. Okay, that was what we just found out this evening, thanks to Mr. Charles Dion. So, how high can our roofers take a look at that, or what do we want to do about this, and what
well,
should we do?
If the wood came from a windowsill or from
some kind of window framing.
Right. That's not their purview.
Understood.
But they're going to be up
there. They're going to be up there, yeah, so they can just kind of give it a looky-see, sort of.
Right. Could you just tell us?
Yeah.
Without, because our other option is to climb out on the membrane roof and look up.
Mm.
Or to climb up to there
you
and look up windows.
You can actually see from the road where it came from.
Oh, good.
Okay. I mean, it's a humongous long strip where you can see right underneath the window.
So. Maybe since he has the crane, maybe I'll ask him to take a look at the edging of the rest of the roof and give us an estimate for the rest of the roof in a year or two time frame.
For the roof itself.
For the rest of the roof.
Yeah, no, that's a great idea, yeah.
So
because
like,
it's not the roof, it's underneath the window.
Right.
Right, no, but this is, we're talking about two different things. So let's keep this with the board. So Jody, if is a crane necessary to do the window work, or is that, I don't even know how high that is would a ladder suffice?
I don't know.
Do we need a special?
That's up to the builder. That's,
yeah.
That's they might use scaffolding. they may use the crane. Depends on what kind of terrain is back there past that membrane roof. I don't want somebody.
What I'm trying to figure out is that there's a crane already here. Is there an opportunity to at least get somebody to look at the extent of what the issue is?
We can just open the windows and look up yourself.
Okay, so we don't really need.
Well, we do need them to kind of look at the. It'd be nice, since he's already up at that level, he can probably see if the rotting wood is on the overhangs of the roof. So, which I'm going to guess yes. So, like, obviously, re-roofing the top of the building isn't this year, and it may not be next year, but. You know, it's not on the CIP, so we have to get it on the CIP, a ballpark, and then we can start saving for it.
So who should we ask, and should we ask somebody to take a look at the wood framing? Would you like to think about that?
Well, Mr. Hammond's in construction, and he's on, what is it, zoning?
Okay.
He's a nice
Can we ask him to take a look?
So.
Okay, I can do that.
Mr. Gagnon's going to be here doing...
We don't know when, but yes, at some point.
And they're in construction, too. So, and then you have Tom that can just look at it. And,
okay. Sounds good. Let's see. Bond bank agreement. So the bond bank agreement is in the folder. So the important thing to say is that we did hear from the bond bank last Friday. We have been accepted for long-term financing for the fire engine and the transfer station. So one can say that we have secured long-term financing for all three bond warrant articles. Now, we're going to have to sign the resolution from the bond council, just as we, not the bond council, from the bond bank, just as we did for the USDA. But we're not going to do that tonight because we have to orchestrate and get, you know, our town clerk here, just as we did for the other one. And we do have till the 16th of May. And I spoke to, let me bring it up, because I asked her a number of questions. I think I may have board of the logs. Yes, so good luck. All right, so the treasurer, these town clerk will have her own certificate of voting. She'll be watching us do the vote. She'll certify her own piece of documentation that we'll send along. And then the loan agreement is what she's going to watch us respond to. And it has a board member signature, the treasurer's signature, and her, the town clerk's signature. So I said, they all have to happen at the same time. I know that the town clerk and the board do. And so the bond bank said that the treasurer can sign later. So we don't have to orchestrate it with Beverly as well. Okay. Although we can ask her to come if she would like. The agreements are not due back in the office until May 22nd. So May 22nd is when we have to get from there. I said to them that the fire truck, which in its original application was $450,000, will at least be reduced to, you know, the $340,000 more or less because of the grant that we just received. But that we are also working with USDA to see about financing that. So, and that's when she said, just as long as she'll write a new loan agreement that has the different terms once we make up our mind. So that's where that is. She says she does need to know that by May 12th.
Okay.
And then she'll fix the paper so that...
Do we want the USDA bothering with the fire truck after they're giving us such a hard time on a culvert?
Well, that's a good question.
Like, I'm afraid they're going to be like, well, now you got to watch somebody buy the fire truck.
There's no engineering, so this is different. So the two laws that we went through that were in January were for their stormwater and wastewater programs. So this is community facilities, and it's a vehicle. So
it doesn't have any of those issues. However, you know, we'll know. I mean, she'll give us the loan, she'll give us what it is to look at, and so we'll see what, if there are conditions that we don't like.
Right.
And we'll see what the terms are, and we'll be able to balance it out with the terms from the bond bank.
We'll know that by then.
Well, we should. We'll have, you know, if she can't tell us, then that will sort of force our hand, right? If USDA can't give us a reply, it'll just force our hand. It is currently written as 10 years for both, for the fire engine and the transfer station. And it's currently written at 3.5%. But that's the max. So it would be 3.5 or whatever they're able to sell the bonds for at that time. And they think that, you know, they highball it to make sure it would work. So, but we don't know exactly what it is. So, and there is the possibility of at least changing the fire engine to 12 or 15 years. I didn't process that the first time around. So I'm going to continue to work on that.
Thank you.
So we don't have to do it, but you know, if you want to look over the loan resolution, you know, take it home or, you know, look at it online. However, we do have it. We're not going to act on it tonight, and I'll try to coordinate it for a time when we can get the town clerk here. And so I think that piece of information about the Derrick grant is not public, so we should at least announce it. We heard Michael was our eyes and ears at the governor council meeting on Wednesday, and it was item number 50 something on their agenda, but it passed without discussion, correct, Michael?
62, I think.
So we did get the Derrick grant for the full 109,300, whatever it is. We'll get an official announcement soon. I saw Liz Strahan at the SRPC meeting on Friday. Thanked her for, she's our DES contact, thanked her for her help and support. And at some point before the end of September, because that's how the agreement currently still reads, we'll put in the no cost extension of time with DES/EPA so that we can extend it. I told her when we were expecting the fire engine and blah, blah, blah. Planning board rate schedule. Do we have a rate schedule somewhere? Did you see a rate schedule?
Yes. You mean for the bond?
No, a rate schedule for planning board fees.
Oh, no, that's not in here.
Turns up. I mean, we'll vote on it if it turns up in Jody's. But what we're trying to do is act on the fees that the planning board is recommending to us based on the public hearing. So we'd love to do that, only we could see them.
She emailed. She didn't email everything. She just did.
What? Today?
No, last week.
Well, if you can find it. Try to work with it. Okay, review of legal priorities. I haven't compiled them yet, so we'll table that again. Stratford MPO, that is part of the Stratford Regional Planning Commission. They're like two separate enabling pieces of enabling legislation. But this Stratford MPO is that part of the SRPC that works on transportation. And so on the 10-year road plan draft, our traffic calming for Portland Avenue is on the plan. The plan is going to be a plan that moves forward to New Hampshire DOT is going to be worked on this coming week and reduced to the 10 most important. I doubt that Portland Avenue will make the list, but I'm just letting you know. Okay, projects.
So with regard to our culvert project, we've got offer letters on easements.
Yes.
So let's see if we can.
Thank you.
Okay, so these are, we don't have them all. The only thing that we have to sign is the offer. The easement itself is signed by the property owner. So with these offers, this one's not signed, so we're not gonna do that one. We do have the easement that's already signed and notarized and on file in the office, it's just not in this folder. So I think we should do them one at a time. So Michael, I'll give you this one. This is the Robinsons on 12 Louis Street. And they are offering to sell us their easement for $250.
So what do you want as a motion to accept the, this was the recommendation by Avatar as well?
Avatar said, it was Avatar's opinion that we didn't have to offer them anything, but we, it's really not, it's really better business practice to make an offer for an easement. So these are considered minimal, either $250 for the smaller easements and $500 for the larger.
Okay.
And actually, if we're going, if we're okay with signing these, I see our signatures on all of them, so we can just sign them like we do building permits if that.
Okay.
That works.
You want
yeah, we'll just announce them. Yeah. So this one is a $250 offer to Michael Robinson and Mary Robinson on 12 Willie Street. And it's for 1,053 square foot drainage easement. I'll pass that one to Michael to start signing. Okay. Let me know when you're ready for another one, Sally.
1,050 square foot.
No, 1,053 square feet.
Ready?
Yeah.
The next one is from Michael and June Daniel. D A I G N E A U L T. 15 Willie Street.
Michael and June
Daniel.
Daniel.
D-A-I-G-N-E-A-U-L-T. Daniel.
Yeah.
Dano.
But what was the woman's first name?
Jean.
Jean.
Yes. 15 Willie Street. And it's $500 for, you ready for the amount of the drainage easement?
Mm-hmm.
2,254 square foot drainage easement. Is to Kathleen Adams.
Is that with a K?
Yes, it is. 41 Pine Street. And it is $500 for two easements. One is a drainage easement that's 1,900 square foot. Turn back on?
I don't know. Did she turn it on?
I think. I don't know. The other is a slope easement.
Yes, she did.
The other is for a slope easement of 839 square feet.
Say there's one in the office that's all complete.
I think the east, no, the, so this is the offer letter offering them money for the easement. They had to actually, the easement.
I see.
So the easements are in the office, but we, they don't require our signature.
Yeah.
Just their signatures. And the, there are two that are still outstanding, so this is one of them. We want to sign it because there's nothing to sign. One is St. Lawrence on Pine Street and the other one is Morganelli on Willie Street.
Caroline just forwarded the planning board fee.
Oh.
Information to all of us.
Oh, by email?
By email. She apologized for not working out. There we go.
So is it just these two bullet points?
Yeah, it's in the minutes.
The board then discussed proposed changes to the fee schedule, which are as follows.
Yes.
A flat fee of $250 for noticing in the newspaper and a charge of $10 per butter notification for all applications.
That's it.
Oh, that's it?
Wow, I thought it was like a whole list. No, it's only the two, thank you.
Okay. Did you see that?
Yeah.
All right, well, I will entertain a motion then to adopt this new fee schedule.
I make a motion to adopt planning board fee schedule, flat fee of $250 for noticing in the newspaper and a charge of $10 per a butter notification for all applications. So.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. And we, the ZBA is going to be taking this up, I hope.
We hope.
On.
In a similar way at their next public meeting.
Right, apparently they have a case that's been scheduled for sometime in May.
Yes. Now that you've mentioned the ZBA, you know, per Joe Coet's meeting with us last week, I sent him a, you know, the email history of the back and forth, the appointments, the minutes and that sort of stuff, so that I sent that off to him today. All right, where are we? All right, the easements, all right. The other thing I'd like to talk to you about, we're still under culvert, so we talked about the easement, signed the offer letters. There are a couple outstanding. One of them might require us to do some surveying work. And because, you know, we can't put out the bid package until we get all of these property easements in place, I'd like the board to consider authorizing the survey if we get some quotes back from surveyors over the next few days. And I don't know if you want to think about this a little bit, if you want to say, yeah, it's okay up to a certain amount of money.
Is Hoyle Tanner organizing the surveying work?
They are. They will recommend that we either do it or not.
Okay.
If there's a way not to do it, I would choose not to do it.
Sure.
Because it's expensive.
Sure. I'm only asking, we know there are companies that we've used, a company we've used in the past, which is much more reasonable than others.
Exactly.
I want to make sure that company,
I did ask Caroline to get.
So we're handling it. We're sending it.
We are. We're trying to get information. However, like, Cardigan Mountain is out till middle of May. And so she's also asked Steve Height.
Yeah.
Civil Works.
Yeah.
And is talking to Hoyle Tanner to see if there's anything we can do other than a survey.
Right.
And there may be an alternative.
Okay.
So I didn't fully process the email. It came late in this day, so I don't really know. But it may be that we don't record the easement with the deed, with managing another way or something. Yes. So if we can get it okay, if we have to do the survey, and if it is good to schedule somebody like now, it would be best to have authorization.
I don't even know the scope of the surveying part.
I don't know if it's the whole property, if it's just the property or whatever. But if we did, could it be more than $5,000? Could it be more than $5,000?
Depends on what you're surveying.
Well, that's what I'm asking.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Like,
I mean, it could be, sure.
Yeah. Well.
Like, what was?
hope not.
I can find that email.
Something that came to all of us.
It was a list of the current issues with St. Laurent.
I think I saw that.
St. Laurent.
Just one property.
Oh. Then no.
No what?
No, I couldn't imagine it would be that much.
Oh, okay.
But.
As Betsy said, in order to record the easement plan with the registry, we will need a surveyor's stamp. I can look into how much that, what, like, how much that will be. I think there's a typo there. Otherwise, we can reference the plans better in the easement and not record the plans with the registry. That's what I read quickly earlier today. So I think what that says is that the plans do a better job of describing the easement. It's number two. As Betsy said, in order to record the easement plan with the registry, we do need a surveyor stamp, which suggests a survey.
Sure.
But otherwise, we can reference the plans better in the easement and not record the plans with the registry. So if that pathway looks like it will work, shall we just move it?
So I want to make sure I understand. You're talking about all the easements that we just
No,
or
just
the one.
Just one. Just the one that's not, one of the ones that's not.
Is it a large parcel? Or
it is a large parcel. It's this irregular land on Pine Street, and Mr. St. Laurent is concerned that we will be doing something that makes his ability to develop that land even more difficult than it already is. If that's, well, that's all the others are being filed with the register. With the registry.
But I haven't heard any concern whatsoever with all the other ones.
No, they're not surveying. No, we're fine with all the other ones.
Right.
This is the only, but this one, you can see that there are six, you know, he's been going back and forth.
You want to make sure, I would think, out of all of them.
Well, then we may need to have a survey, so that's the.
If the property owner is already raising concerns. I want to make sure we don't have any concerns going forward. We need to access that property.
Betsy said, Betsy is the woman who's in charge of the easement specialist. In order to record the easement plan with the registry, we will need a surveyor stamp. I can look into how much that will be, otherwise we can reference the plans better in the easement and not record the plans with the registry.
And they don't see an issue with that? Or we don't?
I'm reading.
Okay, there's also like a question for the easement, not for you, I guess. I'm sorry, I'm just taking out my.
So
it seems to me that I shouldn't be concerned about filing this one with the registry when all the others have them.
I can't, because I don't know really any more than you do, Mike, I guess, so I'm not going to try to fudge it. If Hoyle Tanner, you know, they've had a lot of experience with this. If Hoyle Tanner comes back with a pronouncement one way or the other, I'll forward it along to the board. How does that sound? Because I don't have a good feel for these things either.
It's pretty.
So this is a piece of land that came before the board, sort of like by the back door. I don't know whether it's because the assessed valuation had changed. It could have been your first year. It could have predated.
Mm-hmm.
It's been a while, and I forgot all about it until this context. So, Mr. St. Laurent, who owns that piece of property, was part of a larger parcel.
Okay.
So other buildings got
it's
built.
Some on Pond. Okay.
Nothing
before me. I don't know.
And he got a variance from the zoning board to build, but he never did. And then
they don't last forever.
And so what happened is it changed, I guess when it reverted back to just a lot instead of a buildable lot, it changed
sure.
its valuation.
Sure.
And that's how it came across the boards.
Okay.
Maybe he asked for a debate, I don't know. And then I forgot all about it because
right.
we did whatever we were supposed to do, and that was that.
Sure.
Until just now. And so when he was reminding me, he had a ZBA variance, it expired, blah, blah, blah. He knows he would need another ZBA variance. But he doesn't want this easement to create even more constraints on an already constrained piece of property. So the guard, he had an issue with the guardrails, because they were gonna put guardrails.
Right.
And
Right.
they were going to go on the only part of his Pine Street property that had a prayer of being used as a driveway.
You want the guardrails that are there currently, or they would ever put in?
No, they're part of the plan.
Our plan.
Alright, yes. And so they've changed where the position of the guardrails, and they're terminating them sooner.
Okay, well, there's a reason for those guardrails where they are, so.
I understand.
Okay. Now I understand.
Okay, so, well, it's got an issue with guardrails, he's got, he wants reassurance that the Vicaris Drive culvert is not part of this easement, and it's not. There are other things that he's asking that he be notified every time the town wants to work on it. And Will Tanner is saying that's not just not practical, because, you know, road agent 10 years from now is not gonna know about this particular issue. So they're working, Will Tanner's working with the property owner to try to come to terms. Survey could be part of it.
Okay. Well, we don't know.
And the zoning meeting will be part of it.
Well, he's not ready right now, and he says that, he's not ready to.
But we should notify the zoning board.
Why?
You know, we already approved it once, this is what.
He's not asking us to do that.
Yeah.
I mean, it has to be an action on his part.
Yeah.
To, you know, he's not asking for a variance, he's just, when he's ready, and he may never be ready.
He would need to.
He would need to go to, he knows he would need to take it to the zoning board, he just doesn't want to create any.
Regardless, we can reserve the zoning if he asks to go.
Yeah, right, exactly. So, Will Tanner is working with Mr. St. Mark, and that's the best that I can do. And if there's any information on surveys, I'll get it out to you, but I think we need to meet to give a quick lesson.
We don't have that email though, right? We don't have a copy of that, because I was looking for it.
Well, I'm looking for it. There you go. So Caroline. Oh, no, it's from Audrey. Okay.
So when you.
I've got it.
Okay.
There we go. Yeah, and if they don't, I usually, you know, but there have been a lot of, like, just administrative back and forths, and, you know, nothing of any substances. So sometimes one will slip, so here's one that slipped. Okay, it's on. It should be in your inboxes shortly. Okay, back to.
I'm available Wednesday or Thursday.
I'm going to have to check in and I'll remember this time, so. Thank you, though. I appreciate it. Culverts. We just talked about the survey. Oh, the other thing that will have to happen once the easements are all in place is that the USDA is asking for legal to review them. So the board, so I will pass them along to our legal counsel with the appropriate form. Okay. The USDA loan, we talked about doing PR. I haven't touched base with the USDA person yet about that, but I will. I'm also asked to post, you know, the update that I sent along that will be in the newsletter, just put on the website because that's current right now. So I've asked you to post that. So that's just our PR on a lot of things. All right, town hall drainage. Caroline is pursuing with Steve Height, you know, when she thinks we'll be back from annual construction. So we don't have any scheduled date there yet.
So we've called and emailed and sent them a letter or?
We sent them a notice of award asking him to please submit his bonds.
Yeah.
And to, after which time we would get a contract, so we were gonna have legal do a contract for us.
How many you get noticed of the bid?
We had the bid package in February.
No, no, I understand that, but was it mailed out to people? Did Height help coordinate that? I just wanted to figure out why he's not responding now that he's won the bid, that's all.
I don't know the answer to that. But Caroline's talking to Steve Height, because Steve was the sort of conduit.
That's what I mean, so maybe we're not sending it by the right means, that's all I mean. Maybe we just call him and say, hey, check your mail or whatever.
I think she tried calling, I believe she, Caroline is trying. And so I think she's going to talk to Steve Height to see if he can. Concrete pads, I don't think we've seen anything about them yet. That's the one remaining piece of the transfer station. The other project related thing is the short-term financing, so Kenny Bunk is working on a proposal for us, and when I get it, I will send it along. Copying and scanning. So this has to do with, you know, just general purpose conversations about replacing the front office thing. And I think Caroline said that she got something in the, from the company that does RPD. She was going to forward it along to you.
By email?
Yeah.
I know she gave it paper.
Oh, maybe that's it. Maybe that's it. I thought it was email, but maybe it was hard copy, I don't know. Anyway.
Yeah, and she told me that, well, she sent me something back in January 25th.
Well, this is like today or yesterday or not yesterday, but recently.
It was maybe Friday.
Friday. So she probably got busy.
Did he leave a bit?
I thought she, he left, I don't know.
Okay, that's fine. I'll follow up with her.
Yeah, thank you.
I know Mondays are crazy for her,
yeah.
And if he was here
yes.
Friday, then.
Okay. I just know, kind of dropped out of the sky. He was just here talking to Ducharme and must have come up or something. Okay. SRPC Technical Assistance Grant. I got an email from Kyle Pimentel, who is an SRPC planner, and there's $6,000 worth of technical assistance. I don't want to say money, it's not money, it's consulting.
Okay.
That if we're interested, he said he could help write a proposal. So, yes. So, he thought that he could write a proposal to write a grant proposal. This is a little
proposal for a proposal?
Yeah, sort of, for Sligo Road. So in other words, if there are grants available for either one of the Sligo Road culverts, if we are interested, he could use that, you know, he could, if we wanted him to ask him for that $6,000 grant
right.
to write a proposal to, you know, FEMA, whoever.
Okay.
So is the board interested in?
There's no associated cost to us?
I would say, and I would want to run this by him, there's yes and no, not, it's going to balance out, but we may have to pay the $6,000 and then get the revenue, do you know what I mean? We pay the $6,000 to SRPC, they give us the $6,000 grant money. If that's the case, then we just need to know that there's an expenditure of $6,000 that we weren't counting on. But I will check with him to see whether, what the mechanism is. Maybe he, maybe it's just a, maybe there's no cash that actually changes hands, right?
I'm sorry, it's no idea.
What? All right, so.
You want to pay somebody $6,000.
I don't want to pay anybody $6,000.
To write a grant for
yes.
$6,000?
No.
Who are you going to pay?
Okay.
Yeah.
So.
What's his name?
His name is Kyle. Pimentel, P-I-M-E-N-T-A-L.
From Stratford Regional.
Stratford
that
Regional.
That we met with.
Yes. They have some project sale money or some grant. They have some money. They have a pot of money that can be used to provide consulting services.
Okay.
Towns like us. So he and I said, Kyle, I don't what can you do for $6,000 or whatever? And he said, well, let me think about it, blah, blah, blah. So what his answer was is, for that $6,000, I can write a grant to to request funds to repair one of the Sligo Road culverts. Okay?
Okay.
So both of those would cost way more than $6,000. So if there's grant money available to help us with either one.
Okay.
Fine. We, I mean, we tried this route before with the top Sligo. We never got any money, but, you know, programs change, requirements change. This was a few years back. So if the board is amenable, we're approaching the sort of the deadline for the $6,000, and none of us have a whole lot of extra time to devote to this, but I can ask, I will touch base with him and say, okay, if you can write, if we don't have to, I can say to him, yes, you can proceed with that request. But it would have to come back to us to okay,
yeah.
Right? So it's not a done deal. It's just, shall I just have him continue to explore this?
Well, it doesn't cost that, I'm sure.
Okay. And to come back to the $6,000, my only question, and I will get this straightened out with him, is are we going to have to pay him the $6,000 here and then get the $6,000 from wherever that pocket money is? You know, so that, so...
Yeah.
Right? So there's...
So
we're still paying. We're paying, but we're also getting the revenue. It's just that, you know, too much of this unexpected paying starts to have an impact.
Right.
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 So, and maybe not. Maybe he just gives us the time and we don't have to pay. But I will check that out with him.
And they have money to use for technical assistance.
Yes.
I'd rather him go out and measure all the roads and find out.
He can't do that. He can write a, I know, so I understand. This is, I've asked him a lot of questions, like he's not an engineer. There are things that he can and can't do. And so that's, but I want to talk to him about rights of way. That's an interesting one. And it has to have, bear some relationship, it has to bear some relationship with, because it's part of the sea rise. So culverts that are on the Salmon Falls River have a relationship
okay.
to tidal waters and stuff,
yeah.
blah, blah, blah. So that's, that was the,
okay.
that,
so that
was
the,
that's where this technical assistance, yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
All right.
But that's, I'm glad that we're all keeping the rights of way thing in the back of our heads, because it would be nice to get some assistance.
It's great to hand off this
to someone.
Or to say, hey, here
yes.
it is.
You know?
And leave it off on the wall somewhere so we don't lose it again in the planning room.
Okay. So letter regarding trees at Chinburg. I believe Tom has found the plans, and so he will be in the process of drafting a letter. New Hope Housing, we have not heard back from Avatar. We should have asked Chad to meet us there, so it's still tabled. Rec Committee. So there are a couple of items, I think, Jody, that we've collected this week that we should talk about.
Yes, I sent them out as... I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. That's the way it goes. That's the way we do this.
They're cleaning up the shed.
So which shed is that?
There's two sheds there.
Where are you?
At the school.
Okay.
Over by the softball field. I'm gathering.
At the school?
Mm-hmm.
At the school.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the school is building a new beautiful brick shed as we speak right now, because we signed the building permit last week.
Okay.
There's still a regular old shed, wooden shed, that has all the rec stuff in it. Kelly looked in it with, I want to say the maintenance man, Richard?
Yes,
not our maintenance man.
Right, no,
schools.
Yeah,
okay.
They're both Richards.
Right.
Fortier and Fogarty, so
that's
I get, yeah.
Okay.
So that's why.
So there's no lock on the door, it's screwed shut. So
is it only used for rec committee?
Apparently.
I mean, for summer rec?
Yes. And everything is just stuffed in there from what Kelly tells us. So we have to pull it all out, do an inventory, see what's able to be kept and what's not, and bring what's broken or wet to the transfer station, because the roof may or may not be leaking. So Billy and Blythe volunteered her husband to help fix the roof. If you get one of the shingles, he can bang it out. And I'm throwing my brother under the bus for him to help Billy at the same time. So they'll bang that part out. We wanted them to be able to If they have to throw something in the dumpster, not have, obviously have to pay for it, it's our stuff.
Right.
So the recommended numbers are willing to do that.
We can have Caroline write a letter.
So, and then.
Right, and everybody's.
Yeah.
I was, I asked, because I saw this on the, I get your email, and when I came in today, I said, so Caroline, is this like the highway shop? It's like, I thought that was cleaned out. Why, and why is the rec committee feeling the need to do it? And so, mystery solved, thank you.
Yeah, we're putting in a baseball park there, you know?
So when would they be doing this? What's approximately the time?
Dan Hand will start looking at it this Saturday. I don't know if cleanup's gonna happen at all this Saturday.
By mid-May, will it be done, do you think? Or the end of May?
Yeah, sometime. They're gonna do it on Saturdays because the kids can't be there and you need the space to put everything out. And the transfer station has to be open, so they're gonna coordinate as the season goes on.
All right.
Obviously, it has to be done before the end of school.
Okay.
So sometime between now and a month and a half.
So we say mid-June, end of June?
So, oh, yeah, yeah, they have to be done by the 26th, not the day of start of camp, so.
All right, so we can get that. And who should, we'll just leave it in the office?
Yeah, yeah, fine.
Okay.
And I emailed Jeff on that too, so he knows and he can tell the transfer station agents.
Okay, sounds good. So rink liner, so what do we need to talk?
Yeah, so I saw that Mike had asked about that last week, and then a couple hours later, it had said that the fire department had rolled it up and thank you, fire department.
Yeah, I saw that.
Last night, Kathy said that it needs to be moved. And I'm like, well, I don't know if it's ours. We never bought it. So it's still a donation at this point, and it's still not ours. So.
I thought we offered the money to buy one.
And it was bought in.
We authorized money for rink liners. I know we put it in the budget for this coming year.
Right, so it was bought in 2016.
Okay.
A purchase order never came through to reimburse Tia.
Gotcha.
So Tia bought it, so it's actually Sean's and Tia's.
Gotcha.
I haven't received anything that, hey, here you go, or I need a purchase order. So, and then we have to move it. Can we move it behind the fire department and just leave it off to the side with a blue tarp over it? Or the other idea was at the highway shed, but does Jeff want it there? And then it has to be on pallets. To begin with, it's thousands of pounds. So.
Well, gee, you know, if that's where the rink is, it does seem to make sense to sort of leave the liner as close to there as possible.
Right.
So.
But then you're using a forklift over, you go, there's a leach field right there.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a point where you can put it someplace, hopefully, but that's a kind of coordination between the fire department, hopefully, if they say yes, and Jeff, which is out of his scope of practice. Like, it's not something we would normally ask him to do. So he has to make time and two people to do that.
So how did this thing get installed?
I'm assuming it got delivered there.
So it's currently rolled up?
Yep.
And is it on the rink side of the fire?
I guess so.
I mean, is there a reason why it can't stay? Or if it's up against the side of the building? Is that?
If we put it on pallets, so, because then you have the moisture problem of a rolled up plastic with rain dripping on it. So you're gonna have to put another blue tarp over that too, so it sheds off. And then you want it up off the ground, so the animals won't chew at it. So, and then you want to put a lot of, like, mothballs or something to keep the rodents out from under there. Because they've been known to chew up through campers or anything like that. So you don't want them to chew the liner. No, right? So,
have you tried castor beans?
Whatever works.
So, well, I mean, my druthers would be to keep it as close to where it's be. So, it sounds like we have to wait for when Mark is here, Chief Rutherford is here to.
Right, so that's why I co-copied him on the email last night, too.
So, I guess we'll wait We'll wait another week, but that would be my driver. So looks like that we'll have to buy a tarp. You don't have to buy pallets, you can just find pallets, right? They're just here, they're everywhere.
The transfer station has a couple.
Yeah, okay. So, but we might have to invest in a tarp.
Right.
Okay. Okay, so we'll keep it on the agenda.
Yep.
Thank you for the report. Appreciate it. Historic, that's what you want to table, the historical committee?
Yeah.
Policies and procedures, welfare. I think you and Caroline.
Me and Caroline were talking earlier. I talked to Todd from Rochester. He's a good friend of mine from high school. And he sent over to Caroline their welfare guides and just sort of form-fitted to us, so, you know, no sense reinventing the wheel. We do have one adopted from 2013. Looks like before.
It's just as amounts, right, mostly, I think it.
Right, and then you would just update it yearly. So you do have a little more, but it's nothing like what you're looking for.
Yeah.
So, and it was adopted, so there is.
Something.
Something for now.
Okay. Well, good. Thank you for that research. You'll keep plugging away this with.
Yep.
Caroline, that's excellent. A conflict of interest. I asked Caroline to get some more data about who we should cover. And so I'm still working on this one. And it sounds like what we're getting, hearing back is that everyone is really covered. But by everyone, I mean town officials, both elected and appointed, employees.
Mm-hmm.
So they all need to be made aware of it. But as far as disclosing annually, that's the piece that I'm trying to, I don't think we need to ask everybody to disclose annually, just maybe let them know every year, remind them every year about conflict of interest. And drug-free workplace, Jody's been working on that, and I thank you for sending something for us to look at. I did read that. Are we ready to have a discussion?
Mm-hmm.
So the first item that I came across, you had already, I think it must have been you, Jody, who highlighted it, was that was item number 6. It said all supervisors are responsible for being alert and reporting all possible violations of this policy to the select board. In addition, employees who believe that they have observed a possible violation of this policy are encouraged to notify the select board immediately. So, I mean, face value, we look to be the sort of the appropriate people, but it did, I did have a question in my own mind. Is there any value to having them being reported to the police? Only because there's a violation.
Well,
I mean, it's a question.
That's why I highlighted it.
Yeah.
My work, it goes to the HR director.
Exactly. So, exactly.
Like, we are the HR director.
Yeah, we're just everything.
Yeah.
No, it was a good first choice. I'm just wondering, we can keep that, you know, make sense? Or is there any value in having it?
The last one, I think.
Yeah, we should have when he was here. Okay. Yeah, we'll ask him the next time. Okay, so that was one question.
I'm uncomfortable with that. I think that's fine.
Yeah, I
think. I don't.
Well, we can always refer.
I don't disagree with
him.
Yeah.
We may have to go back.
He may have a reason why not. So.
Here. The other item was just a formatting issue. That's not. Then I wondered about the whole section on employee medical examination and fitness for duty.
Well, that came from my work, so I was like, I don't think I need any of this, but I'll leave it in
and
I'll ask them.
So that was my thought, too. So clearly the police have something like that.
Right.
That covers all of them.
Yeah, we just need the
what's
piece.
Above.
Yeah.
So we'll just remove that piece.
Right.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah. Mine is even longer than this because it has to do with providers and all of our shots and everything else. I took all that out.
Beautiful.
I'm like, okay, I don't think we're gonna do TV and all that testing.
Okay. No, I think this is great. We'll ask Chief Ducharme what he feels about the reporting piece. We'll remove the employee medical examination fitness.
Mm-hmm.
I'll stick it in, you know, our letterhead the way in the format of our other policies, I think we'll be good to go.
Yeah.
So thank you. The only other piece, I'm going to go back and look at what we got from USDA, and there may be, we need this, but there may be something else like posting a poster or something.
Well, that was one of the things that I sent you in that email is.
Oh, did I miss that?
The links above, is where you can buy those signs. They're like $11 a piece.
When did you send, drug policy and attached links? Oh, yeah. Okay, so, all right, so I did, so I put the document on our Google Drive, and these links.
Yeah, some of them are the actual, like, why we have it, and then one of them was, the signs that you can buy, just a site that, one of the compliance sites.
So if we bought like two or three, we could post one here, the transfer station, that sort of thing. Okay, well, that's good. Yeah, good point. Okay, and it'll probably tie in with what the joint loss, I mean, that's sort of a, in a way, a workplace related issue, so. Okay, that sounds super, thank you. So I'll keep this on the agenda, and as we get closer to having a final document, we'll, this doesn't have to go to a public hearing, this is just, you know, we can adopt this when we feel ready. All right, that's, okay, and the last one, I know you're all familiar with this, post-issuance tax compliance policies. Do I feel I have to talk about this, or do you all know aware of post-issuance tax compliance policies? So, I spoke to our bond counsel in the middle of last week, and she went through with me a whole bunch of tax-related sorts of things. Well, they're related to her being able to assert to the people who are buying our bonds or financing us or whatever, that, you know, we're a municipality and that, you know, so any interest that they make on our bonds is tax-free.
Right.
So there are a number of things that we have to, you know, like, again, we can't sell the stuff that's being bonded to a private whatever.
Yeah.
If we make a whole bunch of money, you know, if we get the loan distribution, the loan disbursement, and then we invest it in some high yield whatever, such that we're making money, then that's not, you know, we have to report that. I says, and that's probably not going to happen. Blah, blah, blah. But part of it was that they have, you know, some towns have gotten caught, is the only word that comes to mind, and because they do things in future years that comes back and makes this bond something where the IRS would come and want to tax us for it. And so she will, for a fee of like $450 or something, write us a post-issuance tax compliance policy and show us how to monitor this.
Okay.
So, and I am just repeating it because it came to me and I'm sharing it with the board. If you would like my initial take on this, I don't think we need it. Because we are, it starts to have an impact if we do more than so much bonding in a year. And so we're not doing any more bonding this year because we don't have any authority to do any more bonding. And the likelihood of our doing, I don't remember what the amount was, but it was such that we're just not gonna be there. I mean, even with a police station, we're not gonna be there, even if that were to come to pass. And so, And this is for me. I would take this risk personally, if it were my risk and only my risk to take. You know, because this is the town's risk, I need to bring it to you, the board. And did I forward it to you? Did I forward or email to you? Maybe I did. So let me do that so that I'll keep it on the agenda. I'll forward her email. Yes, I know, and yes. So I'll just if I did it, I'll just re-forward it. Now that you know what it is, you can look at. And the other thing she said, and if I haven't mentioned it to you, is that her engagement letter for 75, for services for 7,500 was for one bond. You know, one, like at the Hampshire Bond Bank. The fact that we now do a USDA in the bond bank, it's going to be a little higher. If we do the USDA in two, if we do bond bank in two USDA bonds, it's a little higher still. So once we determine what the USDA says on the fire engine, we'll do a cost benefit analysis and figure all that out. Okay, all right, I think we're at board member activities and updates. Michael, do you want to start?
We've got planning board on May 2nd, which is next week. Historical committee meeting on May 3rd and a workshop, and we have another meeting scheduled for later in the month. Discuss the pump house.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Colors, yeah.
Yeah.
What else is important? Just forgot. And I'm gonna work all week on,
housing.
Housing.
Excellent.
So we'll have it for next week.
That's super, thank you. Jody?
Rec met last night, we meet again on May 9th. Joint Loss won't meet again until July sometime. We'll be setting some dates with the fire department for CPR and first aid training with the new staff, once the staff is in place. And that's moving forward with that, that's, Lamprey won't be meeting again until,
Will it be quarterly, what is it?
They met a lot last year because it was.
Oh, it was a contract year, right?
Yeah, they usually meet once or twice a year.
Oh, okay.
So I probably won't see them again until the fall, so. And the paperwork went out to NRRA to get our money, from the grant that we received for the canisters. Because now the canisters are in, and we have to prove that we paid for them, and then they send us.
Okay, excellent.
Did the, police space review, or whatever we're calling it, did all those appointees get notified?
Except for Howard.
Okay.
So I set up an email distribution, and I said in that, because I put everybody else there, I said, if anybody has an email for Howard, please let me know, or forward this along to him.
Thought I saw something.
So I didn't hear, well, yeah, because you're on it, right?
Right.
So you would have received that notice.
I should have asked Bob when he was here, when we're planning on starting, so.
Yeah.
I'll let you know next week.
Okay, perfect. I met with Seco Stormwater Coalition last week, Paul Casalt was there with me, this was a shirt sleeve session, it was 4 hours long. It was going through the six items in the permit, and looking for opportunities where the coalition members can collaborate, so they're not all reinventing the wheel. So, I won't be able to go to the next meeting, I'm hoping Paul can, but it looks like education and outreach, that's a perfect one to not have everybody doing the same thing. So that was a really good session. And then SRPC, the Metropolitan Planning Organization, met on Friday. And Liz Strahan was there from DES, I was able to thank her for all her help guiding our fire engine through its grant process. And that's when I told you about the 10-year plan. So we're on the comprehensive list, but it may not be part of the projects that actually go get recommended to the state. And then this week, the budget committee is meeting on Wednesday.
Oh, yeah.
And I think that that is it. We're going to continue to work on the easements, and I'll let you know as those go forward. That's it. So, building permits?
We have, there are two letters that need to go out regarding building permits.
Okay.
It's work that's been done without a permit. One is for 11 Cricket Lane, repave the driveway. And the other is 426 3rd Street. They put a new roof on it. So we need to ask Caroline to send out letters.
All right, I can sign them if the board is okay with that.
So that was 11 Cricket Lane,
okay, very good.
426 3rd Street. And
is this from Caroline's or she?
Yes.
All right, so we'll just get correspondence. Okay.
The next item we have is from Eversource. It's a petition and pole license, so they can put a pole in our public right of way. It is the license for one pole located at Old Mill Lane in the town of Rawlins.
And it's a location where there has not been a pole today?
Thank you for that question, yeah, I see. We'll find out together. I'm assuming, yeah. Public Service Company of New Hampshire, also known as Eversource, in northern New England telephone operations. Okay, Request and Fairpoint and some other company. New England telephone operations, northern New England telephone operations. Request a license to install and maintain underground conduits, cables, wires, maintain poles and structures with wires, cables, conduits, and devices thereon, together with such sustaining, strengthening, and protecting features, fixtures, as may be necessary along and under the following public ways. License for one pole, and that's got to be a new pole.
Oh, maybe this is related to the house that's being, that is being put up, that's going up there.
More than likely.
It's subdivided.
Yeah, some, yeah, yeah. So I assume that we're fine with this? Okay. I don't know, it's the jet.
No, so there's, yeah, there's just two copies, two or three copies of it. Three copies of it. Well, this would have been helpful if this had not been at the bottom. Dear Town Clerk, Public Service Company of New Hampshire, also known as, I'm not listing them all, requesting permission to install and/or replace a pole located in the town of Rawlins, written close to review of three copies of petition and pole license number 611374. Upon approval, please have each copy of the petition and pole license signed by the proper authority. Retain the petition and pole license copy labeled Rawlinsford and mail the remaining copy of back. Yeah, this is just, if the petition and pole license is not approved, please return all copies of PSNH with an explanation. Please contact me by telephone or email, blah, blah, blah. So, I can't imagine why we wouldn't, but.
I thought that was always the way.
Did you need the easement notice tonight?
Oh, no, no. But I've been taken by surprise.
Very much so. Okay, so while we're signing.
So there's today is the 24th.
If you don't mind, if you want me to keep going.
Yes.
I have a purchase order in here, 11.
The town clerk is also going to have to, sorry, I realize, sign these as well.
Yeah. We'll put them back in her, the envelope from the town clerk, so.
Michael, it's a real good Michael.
The next item I have is purchase order number 1187, made out to Digital Ink Printing. It's from the tax collector. She needs 12 books of a report of tax collector to treasurer forms, forms that she sends to the treasurer with deposits. It's for $117.13.
Do I have a second?
Oh, sorry, second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 The next is purchase order number 1188, made out to the Department of Agriculture from the town clerk. This is the state fees for dog registrations in the amount of $1,250. This is to certify that during the period from May 1st to April, 2016 to April 30th, 2017, I issued 500 dog licenses as town clerk. In accordance with the provisions of RSA 466:4, 41 rather, 4I, subsection B, and section of Agricultural Rules 2804.02, I am enclosing herewith the sum of $1,000, representing $2 for each license issued by me to the above mentioned time period. That's the animal control population program fees, I apologize. And so then dog license fees, the same, different statutory provision, but anyways, I'm enclosing here with the sum of $250, representing 50 cents for each license issued by me in the above mentioned time, so that's why we get 1,250. We are statutorily obligated to do this.
Okay. can I have a second and we'll talk about this? I'm not clear about.
So when we register dogs, part of each fee goes to the animal control policy program of the state, and another licensing fee that the state receives. So they get, for every dog license, they get $2.50 from us. Or from the licensee, actually.
So we're paying the state.
To collect their tax checks. Just like restaurants do their, get the room to meals tax. But we get to keep a portion of it.
So we pay $6 or something per dog?
Right.
And we send the state $2.50 of each?
It's probably not a purchase order. We're not purchasing anything, we're remitting.
I don't disagree.
It's just the vehicle that is puzzling me. But, all right, so we're returning to the state, or we're providing the state $1,250.
You got it.
Okay. All right, I think I'm good with that. So are we ready to call the question? Do you want to see it too?
Yeah, no, because we have to write the check to the Department of Ed.
Yeah, it's just a funny way. Right. I'll call the question. All those in favor say aye.
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 Do we have an Eversource?
Oh, yes.
And so we stick back with this.
Yeah, I hope Caroline is aware that we also need the town clerk to.
I will. Sure, it's going back to that office. So.
Okay.
Apparently that's where they stick everything.
Okay.
There's one other one, right?
I haven't figured out how the paper moves around.
Is there one other purchase or anything? Going back one?
That was, yep, the tax collector digital name.
Okay.
Thank you.
Is
that your folder?
You got it.
Jody, you're on.
All right, so in here is just the St. Lawrence offer agreement that hasn't been done.
Okay.
The professional work agreement with Pike. I was looking this over, and my only question before we sign this is that under cost and payment, the town of Rollinsford shall pay the vendor the amount of blank, 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 blank.
Yeah, I mean, I'd rather look this over. We've notified Pike, so he knows it's on its way. So
yeah.
I'll ask her to send it electronically, and we can take a look at it.
So it was
yeah, she did an oversight in it. She needs the amount, which is 130 something.
Right. So,
I mean, I would feel better. I mean, you know, at 10 minutes of 9, it's
yep.
not the time to look something over for the first time. So ask her to send it by an email. Maybe she's already done it. But.
Regarding authorization of bonds and approval of the loan.
Okay, so that's the material from the New Hampshire Bond Bank. We're not ready to act on that, so you know, people can look, review, but you also have copies electronically.
Yes, and this is also the loan agreement that goes with that.
Exactly, so we will be coordinating some Monday with the town clerk.
All right.
So we'll put that there.
So, and this is for, they are asking for an extension of time, the hydro plant project for their relicensing on January 17, 2017, and supplement on January 31st. Green Mountain Power Corporation filed a request for extension of time to file documents as required by ordering paragraph C of the ordering approval transfer of licensees for the Kelly's Falls and LaSalle Falls,
so they're
and
asking,
we are one of them.
They're asking FERC for, is this going to the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, is that?
No, I didn't say so, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission.
Okay,
yep.
So they're asking for an extension of time from FERC. Can I just see that?
Yep. So, and we are on the list, there's several that they're in the process of doing.
Sounds like they did get an extension. And this is just the report of it in the FERC report. I mean, We're in the process right now, in the licensing process. The folks who might have some objections or want to institute some conditions on the licensing are making their case. So people like New Hampshire Fish and Game, the main counterpart of Fish and Game. Folks like that, DES and the main counterpart of DES.
This is the Citizen Bank statements for their credit cards. Jeff spent $302 on various visits. Kevin Heard from the fire department spent $160 on various things, and Caroline spent $70 at Home Depot. My only question is Jeff's. He went on the 5th, the 7th, and the 8th of April. And then in March, he went on the 21st, the 22nd, and the 24th. So are they, like, is he in the habit of keeping under the $100 mark?
$200.
But from before, it used to be under $100.
But but we did say that with the credit card that could go up to $200.
Right, because he's making a trip every day for $30. You know what I mean? So, like, and he could have just needed something else that day. It could be like a legitimate reason. We just didn't happen to have that. I don't want him to go like three times a week.
Right, but even so, even if you add these three, it's still within the $200. So
right.
So
the point is, does he need to make multiple trips?
Yes, and that's, I don't think he's doing it in order to stay within a whatever, I think.
Yeah.
So then the question is, could he be more judicious with his trips? And that's a good question. That's a good question. Although two of them have the same posting date. So part of it could just be when the credit card company is doing its...
No, I'm looking at that trip, the actual date, well, going several days.
Oh yeah, I see what you're saying. Yeah, 70. Yep. I don't have a, you know, we can ask him.
So that was my question last year. Like Kevin went to the and got toilet paper, Richard went and got toilet paper, Jeff went and got toilet paper. Can't we coordinate this better?
Yeah, I mean Kevin goes the 22nd, the 28th, and the 3rd. I mean, you know, right? Yep.
And it could be legit, like he could need a bolt or whatever.
I'm sure the purchases are legit. I mean, the question remains, you know.
Right, and it just wasn't in-house, and that's totally fine. But just a question. Oil and Tanner invoice.
Yes, so I've already authorized this, but I'd like the board to see those.
So I looked at it during the meeting, so Mike wanted to see it.
Yeah.
And then, is this our copy from the water department? It says, for website, see Mike, and it's the Department of Environmental Services letter of compliance.
So you recall, Michael Funk gave that to me.
This thing right here?
Yeah, the letter there from DES.
Okay.
Oh, see you, Mike.
Yeah. We received a letter, remember?
We have in the past. You mean saying that they're out of
compliance?
Yes.
This is the letter saying that they're back in compliance.
Oh, okay.
They would.
Very good.
Look favorably upon it, it was put on the website like the other letters.
Oh, okay. Absolutely.
That's what I thought.
If you give that to me, I'll scan it and make sure it gets up there.
Okay. Good. Barrington Planning Board is sending us a notice of a zoning hearing for the Early Childhood Learning Center at 77 Ramsdale Lane in Barrington.
Again?
A new location.
Want to inform us, but
I don't.
This is the same. I remember it was early childhood, was it? So I don't know why they have us on the list for this, but
yeah,
I'm not aware of any interest that the town of Brownsford has in that location.
Okay. Shoreland permit of notification.
So this is the entire document. Remember, Aaron came last week.
Yeah, and you signed it.
Yes, I should have. Should be. Somewhere in the middle of that.
And this is a copy of it.
Yeah.
So where would you like this file?
I would love for Hoyle and Tanner to give me an electronic copy of it, but you can have Caroline.
It's a file here for culverts. 2017 culverts.
Okay. rather than having somebody scan it and file it, it'd be nice if they could just give us an electronic version.
And then this was just old from last time. Comcast renewal process, which we already had our hearing on, and roads that DOT will be paving come the summer. I just left it in here so we notify them when we find out.
Okay, perfect. Is that it?
That's it.
All right, any community comments, questions?
Go ahead.
Oh, okay. The tree that's down in the cemetery, do we have any plans in the near future to get this?
No, Michael just said it was on his list to talk about, so.
Jeff, but he wasn't here tonight, so.
We'll try to remember to ask Jeff.
I don't think that's the cemetery, I think that's.
It's us.
Morton Park.
Well.
Yeah.
It's in front of the cemetery.
Yeah.
And the other thing is, can you tell me whereabouts is the drainage that we're gonna be putting in? Whereabouts is that gonna be located?
Around the foundation.
So you'll have to be moving stairs?
No, that wasn't part of the plan that I'm aware of.
Okay, I'm just trying to figure out how they're gonna get underneath.
Well, we, there were files planned, there were plans filed.
Okay.
So the engineer wrote up specs, so.
All right, I was just curious because I figured that you would have to have some sort of a notification.
The, once the bid package went out, there was a compulsory pre-bid meeting, so contractors had to come. So they worked with the engineer to go all through it, so they know what has to be done. I you know, I'm not remembering all of those details, but they were, the engineer wrote it up, the specs, the contractors reviewed them, asked questions, and then submitted their bids. I don't know about this, I don't know what to say.
It's just an aw shucks, because maybe then they could have replaced.
Oh, yeah, we could get ADA compliance steps. Nice try, Nancy. I appreciate the spirit. That's a lovely thought.
All right.
Anything else? Okay. I don't believe we have.
Do you have some?
We do have some.
I got a question.
Right? Yeah, we have non-public or personnel stuff.
Yes.
Yeah, oh, Charlie has a question.
Yeah, I come up with just general information, but the dog license fee, ours is 50 cents more on everything than the Dover is. We pay 50 cents more for every dog in Dover. Just general information.
Yeah, I don't have an answer for that.
I haven't registered yet, but I will. I'll ask when I register.
Yeah, ask Kate.
Yeah, well.
Yeah. I don't know. It's interesting. I thought they were sort of standard, but.
That's what I thought, but. Because I think the state gets 250. And even for a regular dog, it's $3.50 here, where Dover's $3 for a senior. I'll ask her when I register.
Okay.
I get till the end of the month.
Okay. All right, anything else? Okay, we do have a, we have to go to non-public for a personnel matter. So I would ask Michael.
Yeah, we're going to non-public session for the purposes of.
Roll call, Michael.
Yes.
Jody?
Yes.
Suzanne, yes. Now I will.
I'll move to the school.
And I will.